Righty then, welcome back. Stephen Howson, bit of a ranty time. Just wanted to expand a little bit. You've probably seen that clip going around on Twitter from the podcast I did with Jay and Joe yesterday on Stretford Paddock, basically just saying, if you don't like it, fuck off. Absolutely stand by every single word I said in that, but I wanted to also drill down into it and look at the problems a little bit deeper. And obviously, it's a great soundbite in it, but ultimately there's a lot of truth in what I was saying in that, in how Manchester United need to fix up and progress and move forward. And there's far too many players at this football club with far too much power. And I think that exists across the entire game, in all honesty, as well. Certainly the professional game. But, you know, it is what it is. So let's get into the actual details, and I think that's worth us doing. Ralph Rangnick's been in charge for like literally a month. And in that time, there's been a hell of a lot of reports coming out of players wanting to leave. Tony Marshall, Cavani, Van der Beek, Dean Henderson are the main ones that we've sort of seen. Players seem a little bit unsure with Ralph Rangnick's regime, apparently dissatisfied with his methods, such as training times, and they had the audacity to complain that they're coming home in the dark. Anyone that fucking works a regular job, all of us that put money in their pockets as season ticket holders through Sky or wherever you watch your TV, had every single right to see their ass with that as a comment. Rio got a lot of shit years ago by saying, spare a thought for all those footballers who can't go out on New Year's Eve. Quite rightly, got a lot of shit. Completely misjudged the temperature of the room, saying something like that. And that's where this comes from. Complaining about coming home in the dark. Listen, fuckers. Everybody that works a normal job, 9 to 5, through winter, comes home in the dark and quite often leaves in the dark. Getting up in the dark, getting home in the dark. Only ever see my house in the fucking dark because we're not at home at 1 in the afternoon with our fucking page-free girlfriend sitting there playing Xbox all afternoon while everyone else is at work. That to me, told me how out of fucking touch whoever it was that said that. And unfortunately, it paints all footballers in the same way, because it isn't all footballers. Some footballers actually got their head screwed on and pretty intelligent people that have, you know, a real understanding of what a fucking real life is. But whoever made that comment completely missed the mark. They're not happy with the bigger workload. They're not happy with the learning that is required to learn the new formations, the new tactics. Anything that they can complain about, it seems like they've complained about. We saw his methods probably for 30 minutes or so against Crystal Palace, and that could have been the new manager buzz, that could have been whatever, and then the players just seem to have reverted back to the form that got Ole Gunnar Solskjaer fired just over a month ago. Roy Keane foreshadowed this in 2019, and he said these players will throw any manager under the bus and leopards don't change their spots. How accurate that has turned out to be is spooky. And he's 100% correct. The only common denominator, and there's an extra common denominator I just thought of, who's gone today. And I think I owe everyone a fucking sausage roll party actually today. So the only common denominator across the disaster class that we've had since the appointment of Moyes and Louis van Gaal, Jose Mourinho, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, and now under Ralph Rangnick is the players. Some of those players, for better or worse, I've been here since Sir Alex Ferguson. And that tells you the situation that the club is in, that we've not managed in 8 years, nearly 9 years now, to refresh what's going on with the football club. On one hand, you might be able to say, well, he left players here for the future. And I think that was the intention with Phil Jones and with David De Gea. The careers have gone different paths, but ultimately, United still haven't managed to refresh what was here from Sir Alex Ferguson's days. The other constant in that time, aside from the players, has been Ed Woodward, who has stepped aside today as Richard Arnold takes charge of the club. And I'll talk about Richard Arnold in a little bit more depth a little bit later on in the video. Fucking good riddance to Ed Woodward, it must be said, though. A man that has overlooked the worst period in Manchester United's history for 30 or 40 years. The only common denominator that's in there. But yeah, back to what's going on currently on the pitch and at the training ground. There's a lot of square pegs in round holes, and I'm not talking necessarily about tactically. I'm talking about culturally. Identity, ethos, and most importantly, characters. When I, obviously I'm in a really fortunate, lucky position to have a weekly podcast with one of United's best ever players in Rio. And he doesn't realise he's dropping nuggets of information constantly, but he is. You can see it in the way he conducts himself. You can see it the way he talks about his time as a player. And not just his time at United, but also his time at places like QPR and things like that, where it didn't maybe quite go so right for him. There was a character to him. There was a character to those he speaks about and speaks about with reverence. And there was a character about Manchester United. Manchester United was this almost untouchable idea that was above everything and everyone's player. And you get the impression Rio fought for his place in the team every week and never took it for granted that he would just play. And because of that, you end up with the performances that you end up with Rio. And it feels like too many of the players nowadays expect to play without the effort to play. If Rio Ferdinand had to put that level of effort in to maintain at the top of his game, to be good enough to be selected week in, week out, the same with Roy Keane. And I think a lot of it's driven by fear. Fear of not being as good as you could be. Fear of missing out. Fear of failure. Rio said he used to get angry with players on the training ground because he'd be like, you're going to stop me winning. I want to win and you're going to stop me winning with that attitude, with that performance in training, with that performance in a game. You're going to stop me winning. And that's when the likes of Rio, the likes of Roy Keane. And now obviously, if you go from Brian Robson, we mentioned Brian Robson yesterday. You go from Brian Robson setting a serious standard. The start of the 90s from when Sir Alex Ferguson started winning trophies. And transition that through to, you had a 17-year-old Ryan Giggs coming through. At 17, did Ryan Giggs have a character that was going to make people listen? No, he didn't. He was a 17-year-old kid. Bit of a good dribbler. That was it. You had Mark Hughes there. You had Steve Bruce there. You brought in the likes of Eric Cantona. Paul Ince was there. And then you start bringing in more players around those. You see the likes of your Gary Neville and your Nicky Butt and your David Beckham. They mature to first-team players, but they're not... And Giggs and Scholes. And they're not yet leaders of the team. That might be your Rashfords and your McTominays, if they ever reach the peaks that those players reached. But you still have to bring characters in. Obviously, Roy Keane was brought in. Yap Stam brought in. Dwight York brought in. Characters. And then you bring in Ruud van Nistelrooy. Ruud van Nistelrooy was one of the most selfish players I've ever seen, but that selfishness drove him to a level of excellence. And Cristiano Ronaldo's the same. You bring in the likes of Wayne Rooney. At 18 years of age, Wayne Rooney wasn't a character. He was a player with a hell of a lot of potential, but he wasn't a character. By the time he finished at United, he was a character. Someone that would call other people out on their standards in training. Memphis Depay, why are you driving a Rolls Royce to training? Personally, I find it a bit mad that. But that's obviously something within the culture of the players where, in my eyes, it's like, can he afford a Rolls Royce? Yeah, he can. So get a fucking Rolls Royce if you want one. Who cares? But the players care. There's a showiness to what car you drive. And there's almost like levels of car you're allowed to drive depending on who you are. And I think someone like Zlatan was one of the first players to drive a Ferrari to training, despite them loads of the players having Ferraris and Lamborghinis. Zlatan was one of the first people to do that. And think about how recently that was. And for how long United players would have had like Ferraris and stuff. But these are the standards, these are the characters, and these are the sort of expectations that people have of you as a Manchester United player. Where is the characters? Where are these characters at Manchester United now? Who is calling people out on their standards? Wayne Rooney supposedly had Memphis come in dressed like a fucking matador, driving a cream Rolls Royce, ripped him a new one, made him park his car in a different car park and told him never to fucking come back and do that again. Close your eyes and imagine who the fuck is doing that to Manchester United at the moment. Who is going to stand there in front of the entire team and go, what the fuck have you come as? And why are you driving that car? I can't close my eyes and imagine one player doing that. at this team at the moment. Not one. Our captain is a guy who wears an armband. He ain't the captain. And that's not a fucking captain for me. One of the first United squads to be so seemingly disconnected that it's leaked to the extent it has with the public. I don't know if we feel more disconnected from a team. One thing that Ole Gunnar Solskjaer did extremely well is he absolutely managed to turn us into a likeable team. And that seems to have disintegrated in the last 6 months. And I'm not sure the reasons for that. But this disconnect that's allowed the players to come out and say, I'm not happy. Supposedly there's 11 players who want to leave United and there's 17 players who aren't happy. Now, I tried to make a list about who I thought that could be. Now, I don't know this. This isn't me saying this is the players who's unhappy. This is me saying potentially this is who I think could be wanting out. And there's coincidentally 17 names on this list. Coincidence. So that might be the 17 unhappy players. Now, I've gone Henderson, Heaton, Kovar, Lee Grant. All of them can't be happy. Bailly, Jones, Deleau, and Tellez, especially if they're not guaranteeing games, Tuan Zebe. They could all feasibly want out. And then we know Pogba, Jesse, Van der Beek, we know they want out. We know Marshall wants out. We know Cavani wants out. And then you could probably assume, is Ahmad happy? Is Matic happy? Is Mata happy? We don't know. That could be the 17 players. Unfortunately, it's a hell of a lot of players and there's a hell of a lot of wages in that 17 as well. Players who want to leave, the ones that we know of, the likes of your Cavani, your Marshall, your Pogbas, your Van der Beeks, players that want to leave, they're not going to tell the press it's all pretty. They're going to say, I'm not happy and here's why. And they're going to exaggerate things. They're going to put a little bit of gravy on it. When everything's going right, no one talks. Or they say, yeah, it's going fucking mint, love it. And they maybe over-exaggerate that way. You got to look at the people who we know are probably putting this out to the press and asking why are they putting this out to the press. And then asking why these players feel intact. Now, a lot of them are happy because they're not playing, right? Okay, cool. Are any of these players, and I want you to really think about this as well, because for me, a lot of people are just assuming Donny would do better, but is he actually doing any better? Is he doing any better? Because to me, he's not. He's not taken the game by the scruff of the neck and made himself undeniable. People are demanding he gets a lot of run of games. In an ideal world, maybe, but this is fucking brutal. Comment here says, you are the worst, House, and you enabled this by supporting all. I'll support every fucking manager that sits in that chair, mate. How about that? I don't make the fucking decisions in sacking and hiring managers, but I'll support every single one of them that's in the fucking chair, because that's what supporters fucking do, mate. You don't cry and fucking moan about how it's not fucking this, that, and the other. You support. And even though this is me complaining, I'm complaining to get the fucking ones who actually want to be here and work. Another thing I was going to say as well is on Cristiano Ronaldo, he came out on Christmas Day, or New Year's Eve, wherever it was, saying, I'm not happy. Now, him saying, I'm not happy with our performance, I don't think any of them would be happy with their performance. None of them are going to be happy with their performance. Have these newspapers, and it's the fucking Sun and the MEN and absolute shit rags like that, have these just gone, well, he come out and said he's not happy. Ronaldo said on that Instagram tweet he's not happy. This guy said he's not happy. Yeah. They're not happy. No one's fucking happy. No one's happy watching United play the way we're playing and in the form that we're in. Nobody. Not one person can sit here and say, yeah, actually, fucking loving it. Because they're not. So what does happy? Who is leaking the stuff? Surely you know, says Alex. I have tried to find out and I don't know. I have my suspicions, but suspicions aren't proof, are they? But I don't know. If I had to guess, I'd say Henderson, Lingard, Marshall, Van der Beek. But I don't know. I think Manchester United, yeah, we probably, there's a super chat just dropped in here. Don't like it, but it looks like another rebuild's on the cards. That's what I was about to get to. It feels like we're going to have to go through a massive rebuild. The body language of the team, I thought, was very poor against Wolves. And a lot of people highlighted that photograph of the players walking out. And to be honest, sometimes you can see in a warm-up and in the player body language, sometimes you can see that the players are collectively not up for it today. And I see it with my own team. Sometimes the warm-up's a bit shit. And there's a couple of times I've stopped them and tried to say, listen, this is fucking shit. You need to fix up. And a couple of times we've done it and it's worked. And a couple of times we haven't really intervened and we've gone out and lost. And I think the mental attitude going into a game and the body language of the players is very key. Sometimes you look at a warm-up and go, fuck me, we're up for this today. And typically that goes and results into a decent performance. One of the major factors, and this I put on Woodward to a certain degree, is that so many players have been extended. Phil Jones, including this, was extended with no thought. Ashley Young was extended with no thought. Nani at one time was extended with no thought. Just because there is a financial value associated with the length of those contracts. And the way Manchester United's accounting works, a five-year contract worth X amount a year is worth 30 million. So therefore, the player's contract value is worth 30 million. And they can stick that in a spreadsheet and tell the banks that we're worth whatever we're worth. And that, I think, is why some contracts have been extended, rather than the fact that it was the football needs of the team. And ultimately, you get down to the fact that we have been led recently as a business first, or a content maker first, and a football team second. And I run a fucking YouTube football team. And do you know what comes first in that? The fucking football. The football comes first, and what we make as content comes secondary to it. And it feels like Manchester United are the opposite. We want to make content first and prioritise the business side of things first, the sponsorships and the TV money. And then if we can do all right at football, we will. If anyone should be a fucking other way around, it should be my football team, but we're not. We're football first. It's the most important thing that we do. Ragnick's got a seriously thankful task, getting players to work extra hard on his system because they don't want to be here. People who are on the phone to their agent as soon as training finishes, get me out the fucking door. They're poisoning the rest of the dressing room, being, you know, snide little comments here and there, I'm sure. The lack of cohesiveness from the team is fucking embarrassing. And I think, again, it all comes down to the leaderships. You know, there's that cliche, isn't there? Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work. And you know what? We haven't even got a lot of fucking talent. And the talent we have got does actually work hard. But there's so many fucking players that have forgot the ethos. Never be outworked. So Alex Ferguson's team would never be outworked, and it might have some serious quality in there, but you would never outwork it. This team gets outworked all over the fucking show. And I don't even know where you start to begin to unravel this. And that's why I think the only thing you can fucking do is sack the fucking lot of them. You don't want to, literally, without fucking repeating what I said yesterday, if you don't want to be here, there's the door. Get the fuck out. This is Manchester United, and you should fucking bleed to play for us. And you can say, do you know what? All the fucking people that want superstar players here, there and the other, and all of the fucking people who say United aren't what we once were, who gives a fuck? Start with hard work. There's plenty fucking United fans who are really good fucking players. And there's also plenty fucking players. Plenty fucking players that would really fucking improve us. There's a comment here from Christian Endu, says, Howson's a paid member of United PR spin. Blaming Donny reveals it. How? How? Surely if Manchester United were paying for PR spin, in which case, surely I'm due some fucking checks here. If they were paying for PR spin, wouldn't they be saying somewhat along the lines of how much value for money they got for their £40 million investment in Donny van der Beek, and he'll come good, don't worry. Wouldn't be saying fuck him off, would they? Think about it, you absolute creature. Aaron Gunn in the comments there says, bought my lad a new kit with his name on before the Wolves game. Feel tight on the poor little fella. Ah, don't worry about it. It comes in cycles. We'll be good again at some point. Woodward brief making me feel physically ill. Right, on Richard Arnold. So, supposedly, here's how a couple of things are going off. It sounds like he's quite hands-off. And I don't know if that makes it suggest that Woodward was a bit more hands-on, but it sounds like he's going to be a little bit more hands-off. He's going to work closely with John Murta and Darren Fletcher. And they obviously report to him, but he's looking to try and let them lead and take the lead with it, which is refreshing and good for us to hear. Because to be honest, football people need to be making fucking football decisions. As a manager now, what would I do? You do have a problem. And on one hand, getting rid of 17 players in one fell swoop is probably problematic and will certainly lead to disruptions. But I mean, at my level, it's not even comparable, is it? But we have a fucking serious amount of player turnover. Serious amount of player turnover. We have over 100 players in our club across four squads, admittedly, but it's very transient as it is. It's difficult to get everyone to understand the style of play that you're trying to implement when it's not the same people training. That's the biggest thing at my level is I don't know who the fuck's training. So I want to go, in my head I'm thinking, right, next week I want to do this with the back four and this with a forward three, and then, you know, only two of the back four turn up and only one striker turns up, and you're like, fuck's sake, I can't do that session now. At least with a professional team, you know what's going to be turning up week in, week out. But I would get rid of the players that had a value. The older ones, your Matic, your Mata, Lingard, Pogba, Tony Marshall, Donny van der Beek, I'd be like, fucking laters, get out of here. The minutes that a lot of those guys are getting currently, because none of those are first choice anyway, the minutes that those guys are getting right now, you can give those to an under-23s player. And that under-23s player, most of them won't be good enough. But some of them will be, and you'll uncover them quicker by giving them chances. You'll either know they've got it or they don't, but you'll at least know the answer. And the ones that have got it, it could be your Garner, your Levitt, your Laird, your Mengi even. You'll find out pretty soon whether or not they've got the right stuff to be part of the first team. And if they are, sensational. You've just fucking saved yourself a signing. And if they're not, cool. Move them on. Let them go find clubs where they can. Clubs look at wages more than they look at transfer fees. So if you cleared Pogba, Matic, Mata, Lingard, Phil Jones, all off your wage bill, you probably cleared over £1 million in wages. And Dean Henderson as well, he's on significant, serious money for a goalkeeper. You will find players. Even shopping in a bargain bucket, you will find players that are comparable to what you was getting with that. Now, you're not necessarily going to find the same level of quality as Paul Pogba. When Pogba's only available for half the season, well, you only have to look at half the fucking player Pogba is to get better than him, don't you? And I would look to bring in some players. Some of the players that we've been linked with, Kamara, Basuma, Haidara, they're better than our midfield. You can literally go shopping. You could tell me, right, Steve, you're only allowed to shop. Let's pull it up, actually, shall we? Just pull the league table up. You're only allowed to shop in the bottom half of the fucking Premier League table. Just for some weird restrictions. That's what we're saying. We can only shop in the bottom half of the Premier League table, and I have to make a midfield, let's say a midfield three, better than what we currently have at the club. Right, so 10th downwards. All right, well, Leicester are 10th, so this is a piece of piss. Leicester are in there, Villa are in there, Everton are in there, fucking Leeds are in there. This is a piece of piss. Now, Brighton being 9th is problematic because you could have easily picked out some from Brighton. You can go to Leicester, you can get Ndidi and Tielemans. They're 10th. Yeah, there you go. You've just upgraded United's midfield. Super. You got Villa. You can probably take John McGinn. He's comfortably better than most United midfield. Done. Are these going to cost us 80 million? I don't fucking think so. Southampton, I'll take James Ward-Prowse. Right? He's better than most United's midfield. He's pretty good at set pieces as well. Go to Everton. I'll take fucking Decore. He's better. You know what I mean? You can go, like, you can probably take Calvin Phillips, right? From Leeds. You can go to the bottom half of the table and significantly improve. Super chat there from Ramon Diaz. Clean out this mess. New CEO, new director of football. No better time for it. I think it's going to need a fucking serious clear out. John McGinn is run of the mill. I disagree. I think he's got a fucking hell of a lot to like about him. And yeah. Playing Donny won't charge anything. On Donny van der Beek, Donny's become this latest Marshall FC fucking victim where a lot of fans are going to be put off by the Donny FC more than the player himself, because I don't think the player's necessarily done too much, too bad. He's been really ordinary in games. He hasn't taken a game by the scruff of the neck. And for surely for three managers who are desperate for good players to come out, and especially when we're desperate to progress the ball up the pitch, for them to go, I'm not going to fucking play Donny. There's clearly some issues with him. Clearly some issues with him. Now, why Ollie said I'm not going to let him go when Everton came in for him, I don't know. I don't know. But there's clearly an issue, and there's clearly a reason why Carrick, Ragnick, Solskjaer have all decided to not play him. There is some that came out from Laurie Whitwell the other day saying Ralph doesn't think he can cover the distance. And then people are immediately trying to debunk it by saying, oh, he ran fucking 11K, which is more than the average Premier League player covers. He ran 11K in the Champions League. Okay, well, can we compare like for like? What's the average distance run in the Champions League? What's the average run by Manchester United midfielders? Not the average Premier League midfielder. What's, because some teams sit in a low block. What's the average run by United? My fucking players run 11K a game. None of them are good enough to play for United. And I can show you that on the fucking data. Like, quite fucking literally, we have GPS vests on our players. So I know exactly what our players are running like. There, top of that one there. Oh, you can't see that. You see that? Top of that. It's 18-year-old fucking central midfielder, Booba. 10.4K. Not playing in the fucking Premier League. He's playing non-league. He's still doing 10K. And at the end of the day, it's not even necessarily all about running. It's about, can you cover the right run at the right time? When someone breaks on us, can you get over and cover the sort of distance that Fred does in behind those fullbacks to protect us? Because if you can't, then that's literally why Fred's getting picked. No one looks at Fred or McTominay and goes, fuck me, they're real good footballers on the ball. But what they offer off the ball is significantly better what Donny van der Beek offers. And I agree with you. I think he probably needs more game time. And like someone here, Landon Jammy says, why not give Donny the amount of games given to Fred and see what happens? I still see it bothering him. Because you might lose even more. This defence that we've got shit at the minute, it's not really getting enough protection from midfield. That doesn't mean you go fuck it and go full kamikaze. Now, I think 100 times out of 100, he progresses the ball better than either of those two, by far. But let's look at the Burnley game or the Wolves game. Is he going to improve you in that game? From a defensive standpoint, no. He's going to be a massive target for you in that game. And all the people saying, judge him if he gets a run of games. Anthony Elanga has forced his way into the team by what he's done in training. He's not needed a run of games. He's just forced his way in. You got to ask, is Donny forcing his way in? Are you hearing about him sticking around and doing extras? Are you hearing about him doing everything he can? You're not. You're hearing about him fucking crying to his agent. And that says a lot to me. Righty, I'm going to wrap it up there. Cheers for tuning in. I've got a fixture list out with Joe later today. Definitely go and check that out. Subscribe if you're new around here. If you want to support the channel, check the link in the description for our Patreon group. We've got some content coming out this week, which you need to be making sure you see. And I'll catch you guys in the next one. Laters.